Chris Janet Shaka, Oregon State University, Frank's first PhD. He's going to speak to us today on partition rank functions transforming library partition functions. Thanks.
Thank you for the introduction. So I'll be talking. So basically, I have a little bit of an assumption that if you're here, you know some of these things, and I will omit the gritty details for a lot of stuff. Well, but to begin, call what we have for an integer partition. It's a non-increasing sequence of positive integers. It's summed to n. I'll give you an example of the partitions above. I don't remember which ones other people use today, but might be a repeat. And we'll use P of n for that, the count of the number of partitions. And we have Dyson's rank of a partition given by the largest part minus the number of parts. And you can look at the 7 partitions of 5 above, with the ranks get 4, 2, 1, 0, negative 1, negative 2, 4. Go through it in head. And like the initial point of interest about Dyson's rank is that it gives a combinatorial explanation for 2 out of 3 of Riemannian's original frequencies, P of 5 and plus 4, divisible by 0, and similarly for 7 and 11. So the rank gives you something for the first two. In particular, it's take the partitions of 5 and plus 4, group them according to the rank mod 5, take the partitions of 7 and plus 5, group them according to the rank mod 7, you get groups of the same size. So that's the first one. So I'll be using some of the same notation you've seen in other slides, just a big long mess of a bunch of products. And you can quickly check that 1 over q of q infinity is the Jernigan function for partitions. Now, it's well known that we have this eta function, which is essentially a modular form of weight half, does have a multiplier, and it just looks like this infinite product, but with a q over 1 over 24 out front to make some transformation sort of property. And in particular, right, SL2Z is multiplicative group of 2 by 2 integer matrices determinant 1, acts on the other half made by Mobius transformations, and there is a transformation according to weight half modular form. I won't say exactly what the multiplier is, but there's a nice form of just exp pi I over 12, something with a bunch of alpha beta gammas in it. So it's known as just, you don't want to see it right now. Okay, so what does that say? Well, you correct by power of q, and the partition function is a weight negative half modular form with a multiplier. Let's say that we let nmm denote the number of partitions of n with rank m. We have a nice generated function according to something by Durfee square. So this one looks nice, but it's sort of not the one that you want to work with in terms of modular transformations. What you instead do is start with applying Watson's transformation, and you get this form instead. So it looks more like a generalized Lambert series. And to not go into any of the details about modular forms and Mass forms, the short version, both of them transform nicely under Mobius transformations. Mass forms are, you only get real analytic or modular forms who have holomorphic. And you know, like, complex differential is way better than real differential. So, a big draw. And for harmonic Mass form, you have this big, long differential operator. Gets not that. So that's a harmonic. And so modular forms, they're nicer because they have expansions at infinity that look like Q-series, whereas harmonic Mass forms, you have a nice Q-series within something that depends on the imaginary part. It's a little bit. So, call Q series a holomorphic part of a harmonic Mass form, the other part not holomorphic. And right, in this framework, if you say Mach modular, you mean the holomorphic part. And the nice thing about modular forms is you can just really verify an identity between two modular forms by checking finite innate coefficients. For Mass forms, instead verify that the non holomorphic parts agree by hand, then reduce to modular. Now, let's talk about the rank function as a modular Mass form. Take a root of unity. If you plug it into Z, Brinkman and Ono establish that that is a harmonic Mass form, and that's the non-holomorphic part they had to add on to make it work, and write a little bit of a correction, just like with the partition function. You do that, now G transforms like a modular form, but is not holomorphic. And if you're wondering when I say, well, exactly what it is, replace Q by Q to the VAT number, and then that's the subgroup that they worked out, that that's when it transforms correctly. And this was sort of when people were first doing this, so when you just sort of went with, let's get what works, someday we'll go back later and make these things nice. And plenty of people. In particular, Frank Darwin has done that recently. If you take that function, snap on the eta function, which makes sense because 1 over eta is the partition function. Oh, now there's no multiplier at all, and you're on a much larger subgroup. So this basically says, oh, whatever multiplier you had from G must have matched up with the multiplier for eta. So now that just says the rank function, when you plug in 0 root of unity, really transforms, at least on that subgroup, exactly like the partition function. And that is either obvious or not obvious, I guess, depending on how you're feeling about things. On the one hand, well, it's the rank of partition. Shouldn't it do exactly what partitions do? And then on the other hand, if you looked at that series, why should it transform in any sort of nice way whatsoever? So I think when I wrote this slide, I decided it should be what you expect because you set z equal to 1 and get the partition function. But right, it's really neither obvious nor not obvious. It's very nice is the short version regardless of what it is. What I'm going to say is that continues to happen when you choose the right rank. So let's look at some rankings. We have, as in many talks, over partitions, where you take a partition. First time a part appears, you can overline it or not. I went with the partitions of 3. That's normally the one that you can write out all of them. So maybe you do for partitions, you partition 5, but with over partitions, you only ever do 3 as an example. And let's just use an overline on the P to give over partitions. And we have the Dyson rank on over partitions defined in the same way, largest part minus number of parts, ignore overline or not, essentially. So that's one rank on them. And it's not hard to see, I think we've even seen it today earlier anyways, for maybe it was yesterday. For over partitions, have a Q infinity on the bottom for the non-overline parts, a negative Q, Q infinity to give you the distinct overlined parts. And you can rearrange it to eta quotient just like that, just by elementary. Well, that says, you know, that the eta function is a modular form, so now over partitions is also a modular form. It's also of weight half. I guess you don't quite land on SL2Z, you really have a gamma naught of 2 because of that 2 tap. Now you can rewrite it slightly using basically this theta function if you want. And one reason for doing that is sometimes figuring out the exact formula for the multiplier can be a little annoying, so you like sort of different formulas. Sometimes one formula is nicer than another. In particular, I can rewrite it as, instead of having a nu of 2a and a nu of a, I can make it just a nu of 2a, but at the cost of explicitly saying what my negative 1, my I, is. So just another form of the same multiplier, right? It works. You go through some formulas. Okay, so everyone has already done that thing of over partitions of modular forms. Well, move on to the Dyson rank and see what happens. That is not the form that you would immediately guess of the over partition rank, but it is. And the nice thing is when you write something as some eta quotient out front and some generalized Lambert series, those are easy to approach by harmonic multiforms. 20 years ago, it would be kind of a mess, but these days you can just basically use the work of Zweigers to handle these quite nicely. Now, originally, if this was worked out by Bringman and Ono, or let's see, Bringman and Lovejoy worked it out in a similar way to Bringman and Ono did with a rank. And in particular, we won't worry too much about doing things that way. Let's just look at a slightly cleaner way to do it. And what you do is you look at Zweigers' thesis. You look at this nice function that I think we've seen in some talks, a similar theta function to before. And the nice thing is that, well, Unfortunately, the only bad thing about his thesis is that he uses an R, where we'd like R to be rank, but it's his thesis and it's a great thesis, so I'll still use R even though I also use R for rank. But basically what he says, take this generalized Lambert series, add on some other function I won't define, you now have something that transforms correctly under the action of SL2Z. And the great part is, it's basically, if you know what you're plugging in for U and V here, for your generalized Lambert series, you know what you add on to make a transform. So that's why it's nice to have things in this form, because you don't have to do the guesswork of what weird integral do you add on. You know what it is. It's, well, you look up the formula for it, but it's explicitly given to you. There's no guesswork there. And in particular, how does this new function transform? Well, this is a version where he wrote it. Basically, there's your a tau. So it's transforming like a weight half modular form. And so, right, you just get an exponential up front, and the eta multiplier to the negative 3. Which means, if you're wanting to work with harmonic cross forms that you can write in terms of this series, all you gotta do is reduce exponentials. Now, you go through a few Q-series rearrangements, and you say, okay, take the overpartition rank. Write it as some nice product, those are easy to deal with as modular forms. Write it as mu. You want to complete it to a harmonic Mach form, you just replace mu with mu tilde. And then I even write that out. Well, I guess I'm talking about it. So really the only difference. And, oh, it turns out that this term that looks a little bad gets sucked into the part you have to add on. Because, right, it looks a little bad at first because you're like, oh, well, that's weight half, that's a constant. But really it's in the stuff that you add on, it gets sucked in. It's all taken care of. And then you just go through, do the exponentials, you'll find that this completed Dyson rank transforms just like the overpartition function, and it's basically, I mean, more or less on gamma naught of 2c intersect gamma, or gamma naught of 2c squared intersect gamma 1 of 2c, which sort of makes sense that the partition you had basically gamma naught of p squared intersect gamma 1 of p, but the overpartitions you pick up a 2, so there's a 2. And that's a much, if you wanted to actually get rid of the multiplier completely, you'd have to go up to this slightly larger or slightly smaller subgroup. It doesn't seem like a huge savings, and that's easy to explain. On the overpartitions, you don't have to correct by a power of q, which means you're not going to get a big of a savings, right? Partition function, you have to throw in a q to the 1 over 24. Overpartitions, the exponents already match for the a quotient, so it's not as big of a savings. Well, let's do it again. Because we're now at two rank partition functions that transform the same as their partition function. We can do it again. The next nicest partition function after over partitions are partitions without repeated arguments. And that's exactly what it sounds like. It's partitions without repeated arguments. Now we have the M2 rank that was introduced by Berkovich and Garvin. And what you do is you take the largest part, you divide by 2, take the ceiling, then subtract off the number of parts. So it still sounds very much like the Dyson. Okay, well, this was also further studied by Lovejoy and Osborne. And you go through the first with the product notation. You play around enough. You get this eta quotient. If you want to write it in terms of the theta function from before, that's what it is. And this one does have a prepping power of Q, meaning we're probably going to see a big savings of working with a nice multiplier versus eliminating the multiplier completely in terms of the level we have. And in particular, right, if you just look at the original eta quotient, that's your multiplier. If you use a theta function version, that's your multiplier. I won't try to say it out. But it's fairly nice. It's just a negative 1, a nice exponential, and then the eta multiplier. Okay, and then you do the same thing. Start with a nice generalized Lambert series form of the rank. You go through some rearrangements of the only hard part is matching up the notation. You do that, and it's 2 mu's. So it basically says it better be a weight, once you complete it, a weight half harmonic form again. And it is, and the trick is to place mu with mu tilde. Not a big trick. And you can go through and this rank will transform the same way. You have a four, basically a 4c squared for gamma naught and for gamma 1 a 4c, which makes sense because, right, partitions without distinct odd part or with distinct odd parts basically puts you on gamma naught of 4. So you expect a 4 to sit around, and that's sort of the best you can. And if you want to eliminate it completely, you'll have to replace your tau with an 8 tau and go up to this larger, kind of messier subgroup. Well, what can you do with this? Sort of go back to some of the original things that people did with the rank. If you plug in a root of unity, you get basically formula, your coefficients now basically look like the number of partitions of n, where the rank is congruent to a fixed value. And you can define, I'll call that n, k, l, n, you can define them for over partitions, m2 partitions simply. And normally a common question is you plug in an l through to unity, ask for the l dissection. Why would you ask for that? Well, p of 5 n plus 4 divisible by 5, p of 7 n plus 5 divisible by 7, follow from those values all being equal, which comes out of taking the dissection. And a second one of why would you do that? Well, if you look at just even the original rank, also true for the overpartition rank and AM2 rank, plugging in roots of unity and powers of Q for Z, those give you Ramanujan's mod theta functions. So you want to plug in a root of unity and see what happens. And in particular, if you take the rank, the relevant 5 and 7 dissections were done by Atkin, Swinnerton, Dyer. The 3 and 5 dissections for the other two ranks were done by Lovejoy and Osler. They also did it for a third rank without computation. Well, we can also now pick up the 7 dissection, plugging in a 7th root of unity by this form. And essentially, what you do, you take that R that's not the rank, but it's still an R, figure out what your non-holomorphic part should be in each of your components of your dissection. Use that to figure out your modular part, and then you just guess the rest of the 8 quotients in these. Which, well, okay, depending on who you ask, is a fairly easy thing to do, and then you just verify something between modular forms. And what does that mean of using the valence formula? It's really just bound some orders at cusps, and then you say check that many plus one coefficients. Standard modular form. In particular, it's by recognizing that you're working with a multiplier that will greatly reduce the number of terms you need to check, basically for the reason that if you have two functions that have the same multiplier, and they're both modular forms of the same weight, divide by them, the multiplier is gone, and now you're down to a modular function, so a modular form of weight zero, and you get to work on that larger subgroup where the multipliers agree. As an example, I can give you the entire set, well, I won't show you the entire set, 7 dissection because it's a little long, but I can tell you the entire 7 dissection when you plug in a 7th root of unity by checking only for all of them altogether, only 110 terms grand total. And as an example of one of them, there you go. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 generalized 8 quotients. And if you're wondering, wait, shouldn't it be modular? In short, if you're looking at the L dissection, about half of the components will be modular and half will be not. Basically, for the reason that somewhere along the line you have an exponential, and so some terms have to, or excuse me, a quadratic, and so two terms sort of fold in on each other. So about half modular and half modular. And you could also do that for the M2 rank. Unfortunately, when I did that, as opposed to 8, it was more like this, even in the type form. But the good part is, even to get the entire 7 dissection, I only needed less than 500 terms grand total. Even though the identity was like 3 pages long, it was still only well within computable. And what I like about that is I'm fine with something that's a huge number of calculations and calling that a proof. But I really prefer something that runs on my home laptop, and does so quickly. Like, I don't have to go to lunch to check. And right, I'll just skip that and give you a few references. Thank you.
Questions or comments? Frank.
What are you going to do next?
Holly Swisher and I have a generalization of the overpartition rank to an infinite family that includes the M2 rank of overpartitions. We're doing the same thing again, but now it'll be infinitely many, and the problem is just the notation and number of variables.
Any further questions or comments? There being none, we'll thank the speaker again.